Hello and welcome to ATP Report. It's the Katie and Barry show, which means Katie Hopkins is here with us today, but in North America, no longer in Britain. Hi, Katie.
Nearly in North America, proper. Yeah, but as it happens here where I am in Mexico, my Wi-Fi is actually better than at my home address in the UK. Who'd have thought it?
Exactly. Way to go, Mexico. I want to ask you about something that seems a little bit silly, but it's all anybody's talking about in the United States, with the exception of Biden falling asleep on camera, and that is your royal family and the big blow up with Oprah that happened a couple days ago. You were telling me that you actually know Piers Morgan, and let's start with that. He walked off the morning show on live camera, and you have an inside scoop. Why did he do it?
Yeah, absolutely. Piers and I were kind of brother and sister, so to speak, on Mail Online. He was the lead columnist and I was the female lead columnist. And we go back a fair old way. He invited me to his highly sought after Christmas party. I have to add that I did not go. But Piers Morgan is, you know, he knows the game he's playing. He's a brilliant, brilliant media operator. You may love him, you may hate him, but he is such a sophisticated user of the media. He walked off because he had been deluged by criticism, and Piers doesn't take criticism well. More complaints through the official regulator Ofcom than ever in any program in history, 41,000 complaints. Meghan Markle herself complaining to the show, which would have terrified the producers. And I think, and I believe, he was told he had to make an on-air apology and a written apology. He refused, and so he walked off. And now, of course, he's being lauded in many quarters as a kind of ambassador for free speech, whereas really the row was about the fact he did said he didn't believe Meghan Markle's mental health story.
Well, you know, I watched the Oprah thing, and without knowing the background and without having anything verified, anybody can say anything. And once it goes out into the public, it becomes, well, semi, if not completely factual in the minds of the vast majority of viewers. I mean, the biggest question from America's perspective right now is you have a lady in the royal family who left the royal family with her husband, who was in line succession to be king someday, possibly, over, among other things, a claim by her and her husband that the royal family is racist. Mm. What do you make of it?
You know, and this is the thing, Barry, you're a media operator, you know how this works. If you were Oprah, you know, what's the one thing you want out of Meghan for that interview? You want some scoop about color and the royal family. You want something on that because you want that to be the explosive issue. What's the most, you know, the easiest way to detonate a hand grenade in a room in America right now is to whip up the Black Lives Matter movement. And Meghan Markle is a sophisticated expert at segmenting people according to victim status and weaponizing it. She did it when she spoke about her miscarriage, very sad, but that has a certain amount of sort of power to her. Then it became mental health. We saw this with Oprah. She said she was suicidal, but that no one cared. So now she's got mental health. Then, oh, they questioned Archie's color. They said he would be too black. Now she's got the Black Lives Matter ticket as well. She basically lined up every victimhood status you can have. And she made, you can't criticize any of those things, as Piers Morgan learnt to his cost. And my personal opinion, Barry, has been that she is a manipulator. I completely agree with Piers' opinion that she'll make up anything to advance herself. And my biggest question of all to Meghan, and it remains unanswered, is why on earth did she marry into that family when it's perfectly obvious it's not a normal setup? No one goes into that when, like, thinking it's going to be like, oh yeah, a regular mum and dad, you know, regular grandma. She's the queen. It's different. Get over it.
Well, look, we really don't know. I happen to personally have a great aversion to unnamed sources. I just hate it. And the one thing she did was she unnamed the one unnamed source, which is it didn't come from the Queen or her husband, which leaves out, well, everybody else in the family plus the firm with an unsubstantiated claim of, well, racism. And we don't know what we don't know, so it's very hard to opine. I want to respond to something you just said about manipulation. I saw about two dozen Instagram posts that she put up long before she was in the royal family, very sexy, provocative poses with various guys in various situations. She looked like an Instagram media darling, you know, hey, look at me, I'm at a party. Hey, look at me, I'm at the beach. That kind of thing, you know. And those posts, I understand, were swept away when she entered the royal family, but people capture that stuff, you know, like they say, the internet is forever. It seems to me she knows very well, based on her background, how to get press. Does that seem accurate to you?
I think that's entirely fair. You know, this history of manipulation is there, the history of being in front of cameras and wanting to be in front of cameras and wanting attention is absolutely there. Right back from when she used to, you know, she was the perfume model for a while, where she held the bottle of perfume looking pretty. And when she was an actress, she was white. That's on her, you know, her CV, is that she's a white actress. She's just learned now, of course, that it's much more valuable for her to be definitely very black indeed. And then there's other stories that are far darker, like her wearing Princess Lady Diana's perfume to her first date with Prince Harry. And, you know, from a female's perspective, one of the things men relate to, you can always smell your mother. I know what my mum smells like. You bring in a new girlfriend who now smells like the mother I no longer have. You've got someone there who is a next level operator in terms of being able to manipulate people's feelings. And the thing is, she does it all the while, Barry, with this face on. I really want to get hold of her little cheeks and go, because she does it with this, I'm so pious face. And you know that face is acted as well. That isn't a real face.
Well, someday we may know the truth, Katie, but we may never know, because the royals have circled the wagons, so to speak, and the firm that runs the royal family, the non-royals who are the support staff permanently, have circled the wagons. We may never know. I do want to ask you one quick political question in regards to all of this. You know, I was reading that the royal family began having its powers limited by the people outside the royal family going back in the 15th and 16th century. You know, with first the House of Lords and then the House of Commons, and the royal family having great power, but now it's mostly limited and mostly ceremonial. We seem to be going in the opposite direction in the United States, where we don't have a royal family, but now the legislature is being bypassed dramatically by the White House, who's being led by somebody who obviously isn't leading, but is being, well, manipulated by unseen forces. Do you find it ironic that Britain seems to have tried to give its people more power, while at the same time power is being limited of the people in the United States?
It's really strange. It's such a great observation, Barry, and I hadn't really thought about it that way, but it's absolutely true. You know, the Queen and her family are very much figureheads, someone we look to. And actually, the really sweet thing is she's seen, well, I don't know, 20 prime ministers, maybe more, come and go. And it is always a sort of, it reminds you of the pecking order of things when a new prime minister arrives and is all kind of puffed up and feeling very powerful. The Queen sort of pats him on the head and goes, yes, yes, you know, you'll come and you'll go. But you're right. We have that power pushed away from the monarchy and back to the people. It is almost as if Biden has gone into some weird position as king, where no one can touch him, no one can talk to him, you can't ask him questions. He's put himself behind a massive wall. He lives in his castle and he sends out his minions and we don't see him or hear from him. It reminds me of those presidents that, you know, in Algeria, their president is supposed to be dead, but pretending to be alive. You know, how long before that happens in America as well? If Biden died, would anyone tell us?
Well, it certainly wouldn't be the press, Katie, because they're not allowed to talk to him. Thanks for coming on today all the way from Mexico. We appreciate you very much. I want to remind our viewers who haven't yet subscribed to please send the message truth in the message box on a text to 88202. The number is 88202. Push send. We'll sign you up. You'll get all of us for free on your cell phone always. For Katie Hopkins, I'm Barry Nussbaum. Thanks for coming to ATP Report.